in the city, as we always say, but we also need a very good good audience. So first of all, again, thank you, Richard, for taking the time to come and visit us in the middle of the preparation for your new work that is going to open up. I would like to start with a quote, and then I have prepared some questions, but we'll hope it will be a fluid conversation and you will also be a part of it. In your quite interesting, as someone said, sly and very smart book, Theater for Beginners, where he pretends to explain people what is theater all about, and if you want to create your own theater company and your own theater work, he talks about that, instructional, almost like the army's, Master of the Army's, no instructions for the theater. So it's an interesting, clever book and also very profound introduction, I think, to his work. You write at the very end, for at our essence, at our core, we are not professionals. We are amateurs. We are myth, history, and advertising, but still we exist. We are real, and we are simply beginners. It's how we thrive. We begin, and therefore perpetually remain connected to the spark. We ask questions, we thirst, and we learn. And the dissenters complete us, causing us to be better. So the question is, what are we now as theater makers in the world we do live in?
I don't know what we are as theater makers. I know what I want to do in theater. I'm interested in working with. I make theater because I'm interested in working with people. You can make stuff and not work with people, but that's something that interests me. It's something that I feel like I need, and so writing a play on its own and just handing that off is not something that I'm so interested in. I like to complete the process by inviting people to work with me in the room on the play that I've written. So, I'm not very good at like talking about what theater means or why, you know, what's going on currently. I can really only tell you what matters to me.
So maybe tell us a bit about the very beginning of your theater work. Maybe also tell us a bit about your family. Do you have some theatrical roots or connections?
Sure. My father was an actor, I guess, an amateur actor. He's actually a judge, he was a district judge and then a federal judge. But when we were in Fargo, North Dakota, which is where I'm born, he was active in the community theater there, and so he not only acted, but he wrote a couple plays that were done. So some of my earliest memories are inside a theater, watching my. I was just remembering recently that I saw my dad in the play Equus when I was about 7 years old, and if you know that play, it's there's psychological trauma in this thing, and sexual psychological things going on there, and tormenting this character. And my dad played the psychiatrist in that play, and I was just wondering if that has had a lasting impression on me. But also my sister Janice, also known as Jan. She's an actor. She lives in the city. I would go see her in plays. She was acting when she was in college. I would go see those plays, and it was this event that people would go to, and I would go along, and I think that had a lot to do with forming my ideas about theater in the beginning, but also getting me interested in pursuing it as a career.
Yeah, I think I remember that you sent out the recent Trump developments an email with a photo of Jimmy Carter, I think, with your father or
Obama.
Was Obama? So they were community activists or
active politically? Yeah, you know, good Democrats, I'd say, in Fargo, and active in the scene there. And my dad was a World War II veteran. And so that's how they wound up at this event where Barack Obama was speaking, and they got their picture taken. And it wound up in this 30-minute commercial that he made in 2008 for the election. So we were all a little proud about that. And yeah, I think that's, anyway, there was, in my family, you're either a lawyer or an actor or in theater. I actually was trained as an actor. So we moved to Chicago when my dad became a federal judge. He worked for OSHA. And I was in plays in high school and musicals and that. And I wanted to be an actor. And I went to Illinois State University to study acting. And they had a really good program there. I felt very lucky to be in that program. A lot of the Steppenwolf Theater Company matriculated through Illinois State. So I moved there as I got this fellowship at Steppenwolf at the end of my schooling. And that's where I met some other actors who, we would form this theater company, Cook County Theater Department, together. And that's where I guess I got put on this trajectory of directing and then writing plays. I found myself being useful on the other side of the footlights. So
you studied acting, but you're known on as a writer director, a model that is in Japan or also in Germany, not unusual, like Toshiki Okada, René Polish, or so many auteurs du théâtre, as the French would say you are. How did that journey start? What was the very beginning, the nucleus, and why did you decide not just to direct other people's plays or not just to write plays? Or what? And how do you navigate those landscapes?
Well, that's a good question. Yeah, I was interested in music, and I was a musician, and I was in bands also, and I was writing songs for that band. And so I think the writing came before the directing. But in any case, I found that I was not patient enough to be like the traditional actor where you wait for the audition or you wait for the job to come along. I was with some other actors who had similar impatience, and so we started reading plays together, and this is how Cook County Theater Department formed. It was out of this restlessness. And I proposed we were reading plays like Harry Ape, I remember we read that, and maybe some Brecht plays, and then I brought in Oklahoma, the musical, and because I had been in it in high school, and it's such a classic American story and musical that I thought it made sense that we try to do a version of that. And I found I was not only in the show, but then I was directing the show, I guess because I proposed it, but I really, that's where I got interested in directing. So I guess I synthesized over the course of maybe three or four shows in Chicago this interest that I had in writing from the songwriting with the directing, and then I guess I felt like I had something to say, and I never thought back then that it would turn into a career of writing plays and directing them, but I was definitely moving away from acting and getting interested in directing, and then I'm going fast here, but I moved to New York and interned at the Worcester Group. I wanted to watch Liz LeCompte work, became interested in their work, fascinated by how they really were thinking outside the box when it came to making theater and attacking these classical texts like O'Neill and Chekhov. I guess I still was not, this impatience thing continued, this restlessness where I didn't want to direct other people's plays. I wanted to write something. And so, and I feel like in New York, or at least I should say in show business, it makes sense to be a director of your own plays because otherwise you're just waiting around so much. And so I think you have to find a way to And I encourage any theater makers here to do that, to find a way to somehow make theater that way, because otherwise it's just waiting, or a lot of waiting.
Well, along the way, I mean, many do that. Many do have companies do write, work, and direct. But you develop something as it's now known as a Richard Maxwell piece. You know, one of the great marks of an artist is you look at the painting or the film, you say, oh, that's a film by Kubrick. That's a painting by Segal. This is a Maxwell, a Robert Wilson piece. The idea of realness that comes up in your work, and also the amateurish, the non-professional acting. Actually, some people, say, all your work is against everything that's being taught at every American acting university, acting school. So tell us a little bit, what is your idea about theater? What's the idea about acting? What do you want from an actor? What do you want?
Well, I really like actors, and I like talking to actors, and I probably because I was an actor, I feel like I can.
How were you trained? What was your training?
Probably, like Stanislavski, that Boleslavski book, Bobby Lewis came to our school. But also, Alvin Goldfarb, who is an alumnus here. He was the dean of the department there, and he's a New Yorker originally, and he brought Lee Brewer out for like a master class workshop, and I was introduced to the Worcester Group and Richard Foreman, Stuart Sherman, these kinds of artists who were trying to make their own way, and I became interested in following through on that. But my acting was really, I don't know, Meisner, or I don't, the curriculum was based in this kind of Stanislavskian notion of emotional memory. And that's something that I feel has a place in my work or in theater, but I don't adhere to it very rigidly. I think that if I had to say what the work is about, it might be along the lines of you are never prohibiting emotion from inhabiting you on stage, but you're also not obliged to show us emotion, and I think that that's an important distinction, These came out of ideas that we were doing, like making plays in Chicago, like a lot of time arguing about, like, well, what is the point of this? Why? What are we doing right now? Why are we on stage? What are we going for? What's important to us? These big questions came across the rehearsals. They infused the rehearsals, and like for the first play, for example, Oklahoma, like 9 months just like banging our heads against the wall trying to figure out like what's important, and not satisfied with the pat answers or the rote information that was before us, like really having to identify. And maybe you come around to the same conclusion in some cases, but you don't want to assume that. At least I don't want to assume that. And so we came, like, there's this classic thing educating in theater, I think, which is that in order for something to be interesting, there has to be conflict. We challenge that. We go up on stage and be on stage, and there wouldn't be any conflict. There would be me and Frank on stage in front of you all, and that would, and we would, not say anything. So it's like be here in this room, come to this room, and it's okay. And time becomes very important. Silence became important. Distance became important. Spatial relationships became important. And what we see and awareness comes into play. And that's I don't know that there's anything necessarily special about that or new in terms of acting discipline, but it's certainly it's emphasized and explored more actively, or at least it was, and that's something that I continue to explore in my work. And to look at how I was trained in college, I would say that the thing that I valued most was that it wasn't just this one way of acting. There were people that were advocating for different ways, like outside of my own curriculum and my training as an actor. There were directors there, for example, or playwrights. There were grad students, undergrad. There were designers, and it felt like an active conversation. That's all I'll say. Right.
Yeah, I like the one moment you describe in your book. He says he is an actress. He works with an actress. And after the first rehearsal day, she says, is there anything beyond zero, doing zero?
Yeah. Does it ever get beyond zero?
Yeah, and you answer...
No. Well, in this case, I said no.
And she left, right? And
she left, yeah.
And in case of also of a misunderstanding, but it's an important point to make in your theater. So what is beyond this era? What, because there is something, obviously, there.
Well, you know, going back to the conflict thing, like let's say you say no, and you continue to say no, or let's just say you have silence for an extended period of time. Eventually, the conflict is going to, there's going to be conflict, because you all are going to like, what am I doing here? You know, say, do something. And I'm going to say, I'm not going to do anything, you know? Well, you have to make a choice then. You can stay or you can leave. And that's conflict, you know? That's like, but we never expected that the conflict would emerge. Or not just the conflict, but the conversation would become between the audience and the stage, in addition to this conversation that we're having as actors.
Did I answer your question?
Yeah, no. For sure, I think one of the exercises in the book, or what you talk about, is to do an everyday movement, like you stand up. Fold a piece of paper, you throw it.
Take a drink of water.
Take a drink and put it back in kind of a non-attached way, without any meaning.
Well, I can't take credit for that. That's Jacques Lecoq.
I know, but Lecoq, you talked about this. And then also to say, how about speaking a text the same way of an everyday emotion without any, you know, as you say, adjective, you said it in the book, but without any notation, without any intention, to be very, but at leave... And leave that space open. I like that idea of the exercise. He says, I have a 7-minute scene, and he tells his actors, okay, do it in 3.5 minutes. So all of a sudden, they have to, time and space, they have to condense it. And then he says, okay, now do that, please, in 14 minutes.
Yeah.
Then you explain. So tell us a little bit. I think it says something about your work, but what are you trying to find out when you rework a scene as a director in that way?
Well, there's a practical side of that. When you're getting off book, in rehearsal, and just the lines are not coming, I think that's where that came out. It was like, let's do this. It's taking too long. It's taking 7 minutes to do this scene. Let's do it in half the time. And you do it, it's like, it takes a lot of tries to get that done. It's like twice as fast. And meanwhile, you're getting off book. You're learning your lines, right? And you're also, you're in the fast version, you're eliminating... You're not necessarily eliminating, but you're discovering like what's important on the extraneous stuff. Like, because you can't just like blow through the scene and not do the movements or the blocking. You have to do all that stuff that we've staged. But you do get a sense of like what's extraneous. I get a sense of like, well, we can cut that, we can get rid of that. Like what's important comes to the fore. Flipping it around, it's not a challenge anymore to do the scene. In 14 minutes, we know the lines. Hopefully, by now, it becomes a different exploration where you're able to allow it to be. First of all, it's not going to end. Like, let's say you do this scene. This happens almost every time because you've just been used to going so fast, so fast, so fast. Let's say you do it and you get to you finish the scene and you think you're taking all the time in the world and whatever, and you get there and there's still like 5 minutes left, but the scene is over, right? The lines in the movie. But I'm not gonna. I'm not gonna stop the clock. It will be 14 minutes, and so now it's a different exploration, and now the actor is learning about time management, right? How to. I don't want all that time at the end. Like, I can pause here in this line, or I can find, I can explore this time with you. And it encourages this idea that I believe in, which is time is never your own as an actor. It's never your own. You're always sharing time. And whether you're in a large group of actors on stage, or if you're all by yourself, you're never truly by yourself. You're not at home. And so time is something that you need to be aware of. And I think that that can be cultivated, that awareness. And I try to cultivate that with the actors that I work with. And myself, too. I talk about time a lot, I think, because of my musical background. I'm really interested in that. But I don't feel like I can't claim to know time either. So I'm cultivating it, too. I'm interested in it, too.
And you say that the time then allows the audience actually to explore or to interpret or to imagine what might be going on between the actors, because you say that they should imagine it and not.
Well, they're going to do that anyway, right?
So we ask questions, we don't give them, but tell a little bit. Your idea is basically the show really happens then in the mind of the spectator. It doesn't really happen on show, on the stage.
I've thought about character a lot. And when I write a play, I'm writing, usually it's character-based drama. So we're talking about story, we're talking about fiction, talking about narrative and these kinds of things. But I really think that character has been miscategorized over the years. I think it actually is the audience who defines what character is. As the writer, I'm certainly making indications. The director's making indications. And the actor is making indications, intended and unintended, but I really feel like it's finally the audience who decides who this person is that they're watching. And I like that idea a lot. And I like plays that let me in that way. I want to make a situation where, and I don't know if I'm successful or not. I just know what I like to see when I go see theater. And that's where I have room to decide what this character is, and I'm not told so much what the character is.
I think that there's this one quote. I think it was in the New Yorker, where that Maxwell's work is about distillation, and they quote you: "I never tell people to avoid realism or naturalism, or what feels natural. It's just that what I'm saying, you're not obliged to pretend that is what you that you have to feel something, or that's what you feel." Yeah. And I think it is a significant, you know, a distinction. Of course, as you say, it's a story, a connection to the New York avant-garde of a Wilson, of a Foreman, you know, of the Lee Brewer or John Jesseron or others. But still, in that, you know, world which is so successful, we have an Indonesian visiting scholar here. And 2 weeks ago, we had one of our seminars, and we talked to him about, what do you think about New York theater? He said, yeah, it's good, but I don't know. It's all like television. It's all, it looks like they were on television. They all...
So Regina's dad, Regina's from Greece. This is my producer, by the way, New York City Players producer right here. And Regina's dad came from Greece, and I felt I was happy that he saw Isolde, and it's a similar thing. He was like, she's like, what did you think of the play, Dad? And he's like, well, I liked it because it wasn't all this American silliness.
It's something you do explore, but also let's talk about this kind of realness. I mean, this idea of hyper-realism in a way, what you have, or surrealism in a way, of the French about it, but it's not really sur la réalité. But you know, the idea of, you know, what you feel in New York subways and Grand Central. These kind of, many of your characters are security guards, policemen, have uniforms, chains with keys, flashlights, and are people from you know, jobs we would categorize that, you know, white or blue collar job. So you try to capture something on the same time it's so highly constructed. in The Good Samaritans, and the actress Rosemary, or what is her name? Who is actually was a nurse, a registered nurse. You picked her out to play, and you insisted, which she didn't really want to do, to really write things down on checklists and everything. So you really have a detailed attention to do something real within that world. So what is your idea about that? Why do you insist on that kind of realness in situation that are so highly constructed? And
I don't insist on it. I work with actors who are trained.
Yes.
And I work with mm-hmm. people who have never been on stage before. So it's I'm really concerned with the person, the you know, and what they emit, the choices they make, how they think. In that case, like, I don't know who would play that part, of Rosemary.
No actor could play the part.
I don't think so. I mean, I certainly don't know. I mean, they could.
No, yeah, of course.
They could,
yeah.
But I don't know that they would bring to it that.
You're interested
in her. Yeah, I'm really interested in her, and I'm really interested in the choices that she makes. It wasn't required that she was a nurse practitioner during her day job, but it's just like I knew her, and I wanted to work with her, and I like working with people who are genuinely curious. Like, I think I'm a curious person. I'm interested in like what things will yield, where they'll go, and I want to work with people who are also curious. And in that case, Rosemary, she was reluctant, but I felt like she could do it, and I felt like she brought something to it that no one else could. Yeah, I feel very lucky, you know, that she did that. But it's not about, like, was she an actor? Wasn't she an actor?
Well, it's also that distinction doesn't really exist in that way because she's a performer. And
I'd really try to keep it one-to-one, my relationship to people. Like, I address the situations that come up with the individuals that I work with, and I can't just have a blanket conversation. I can't even go to that book, you know, and say this will solve the problem. You know, it's really like... there's something interesting going on. I can't really identify what it is, but I wanna take some steps here to figure this out with you.
Yeah, and I like the idea that you said to go back to that. She had this that clipboard to please write everything out. Your people go and check the heat regulations, whatever. They really went to go to the temperature regulator for the. So you insert something of a realism in something where a lot of people who sometimes have a hard time with your work say, you know, it's so flat, I don't feel any emotion, I can't.
Who says that?
Some people who we, of course, think there's something so highly interesting, so highly unique, and something is so real about it. But as someone did say also, you know, and that's in The Good Samaritan, there's an orgasm on stage, but she could also be reading a shopping list, and from the tone of voice, there is no difference in it.
I don't know about that. A shopping list.
Yeah, or whatever, or one of her dialogues. I mean, it's not, of course it was different, but I'm exaggerating, but still, there is that beauty in that stylized neutrality, which you are looking for, and you also talk about in it. And I find it quite a unique force in theater, so in New York. You're one of the few New York artists who tour. There's the Wooster Group, or there is Neutral Theater of Oklahoma. Very few companies do that in New York City because it is a unique handwriting. So this idea of, do you really go, say, are these flat lines? You just deliver the speech? What is your ideal delivery of a text, of a line?
I don't have an ideal. There really isn't. It's
how do you create it then with the actor on stage?
Want to do it right now?
Sure.
Okay. Take this speech here. You want to read this? Mm-hmm. start there. So this is from a play called House. It's Frank Hentschker, ladies and gentlemen. He'll be playing
cities.
the part of father.
Father.
Yes.
Cities. There are a lot of cities and a lot more towns and villages. I've been to a lot of towns and cities. They are all the same. They want the same thing. They all have streets. They all have governments. They all have civics. They all have people who want to see better things for their community, nice things. And they have problems too.
There's more.
Oh. We all have our problems and disagreements. People might disagree, but that's okay. But you can't always agree. You don't have to believe everything. You don't have to belong to every club. There are some things that you don't agree with, and that's okay. But there are things that keep the city together, to make it working, to make it logical. I think about logical things, nature. Look, like at your house. You know all the rooms, you know all the different rooms, you know all the outside. You can look at the outside of this house. You can look at the yard and over the fence. You can look at that view. That's something you do not see every day. I think that is beautiful nature. You and I, maybe we don't think like we do, like they do. If we see them, or if they see us, maybe they wouldn't look at this. I would count this as important, but I'm not them. See, they and I, we couldn't think that, but with that much pride, you would never get away with this life without hurting someone or not even noticing. So we can think and not be pushed to think a certain way. You, anyone, I think you should think about these things. You and I think you should take pride in some of these things.
Okay, nice. Now, when you read that,
mm-hmm.
were you consciously trying to do it in what you think my style is?
I would try to get through the lines. No, I would not. But I would certainly not overact it and put any psychological things in. But I try to read the text, yes, and a bit more.
So what would you want to do with that text?
If it would be me?
Yeah. It was you.
Yeah. Okay, well, I would say I would like to find a way I deliver the text so I don't stand in front of it, so you know that it shines through and that it's not about me. That is, so I bring the text out.
But how are you going to do that?
Well, I would listen to your advice in the book. Say, you know, you learn the lines, okay, you repeat, you own it, and I would, you know, try to, be able to deliver it, that it's a fluid way.
Well, you would, yeah. I mean, that's a very willing actor in my company. But I want to know what you want to do. Like that's I think that's important, and that's something that whether I've written the material or not, or I'm directing the show or not, I want to know what you want to do with it. And I'm not saying you have to answer that right now, but that's where the conversation begins. And usually, it's started by the actor doing that. By saying, well, this, because that's what training acting is in most cases about. It's like, make a decision, decide who this character is, decide what they want, and go in and do that. So I'm just not, I want to examine that. I think it's great that you have the capability of making choices, but it's not off the table in terms of discussing it or examining it. And, nor should it be. It's not, that happens in probably most productions where you have a conversation about it. But I really want to identify what brought people here, what keeps them here, why they come back. And you know, because I feel like I know why I'm doing what I'm doing. I just want to make sure that you're doing for the reasons you want to do it and that they can live happily together. Those reasons and you know you but at the same time you did it, you also got through it, and I can't no one can take that away from you. You performed that and performed it well, you know. You communicated what was on the page and you inhabited the character such that you all, watching it, got a character, a sense of character. And you know, am I wrong? Did you see? you guys can tell me if I'm wrong, but I think that it's so. Yeah. Sure.
Oh, okay. Oh, this is fun. I just said that maybe it's a question of semantics, but I didn't see Frank inhabiting. I saw him, you know, Frank sitting there and reading a text at arm's length.
I think it is semantics. You know, he wasn't memorized. I pictured him standing up. We bring a lot of expectations, don't we, when we sit down and watch something. And that's one of the things I think that I'm battling is our people's history of viewing theater. And that limits the options, actually, for what a character could be. But let's say he was off book. Let's say he memorized it. Let's say he was in costume. Let's say he had a Miami Hurricane starter jacket on, you know, and stonewashed jeans. And some complicated sneakers, and gel in his hair, and a mustache. You know, now we're talking. You know, now it's. My point is, the synthesis that is character happens with you guys. It may not meet your standards, but it's still there, and I like that baseline. I like starting from that baseline and establishing the conversation arc there.
Yeah, and I think you also in the very beginning of your book say, you know, what you enjoy most in theater is talking with the actors about the text. So you really, to answer the question, you do really create it in a dialogue, and the actors are as much the creator as you are. But coming to your writing, how do you write? Do you write the text before the show starts? Do you write on a typewriter, on a computer? Is it a year ahead? Done, then how do you distribute the text? How does that mechanically, how's your writing process?
It really varies. It really, sometimes, I usually write on a computer. I like Google Docs, to be honest. I really.
So you at home, you have a writing room?
I used to be a Word guy, but then I moved to Google Docs. But sometimes, you know, you just gotta shut the computer and pick up a pencil and write on paper. A lot of writing happens in rehearsal. Like if you were cast as father in House, I would probably, I don't know that I would change an existing play, but if it's a new play, I'm gonna tailor the language to some degree on how you're performing and who you are, and what's coming off. And then also after an audience comes in, the writing will continue and change and. I even write on my phone.
You after
know?
Opening,
I write on my phone. You know, sometimes, but yeah, after it's we've started performances for sure.
And do actors have something to say? Can they choose lines, suggest lines? How does?
No, I mean they can, but I think that's probably where I'm kind of old fashioned in that way. I spent a lot of time thinking about these lines and, you know, like a year maybe, and then for an actor to come and propose something that's kind of weird. It's a little weird to me. By the same token, I'm not giving the actor, I'm not telling them how to say it. I would never say like, well, Frank, why'd you say it like that? Say it like this, you know what I mean? Cities, I've been to a lot of cities. You know, I wouldn't, like, there are directors who do that. They want it to sound a certain way. I guess what I'm saying is I believe in a certain, like, division of labor. And that's old fashioned, but it's the way it is.
So who influence you, but also who do you look up to when it comes to directors or writers? What are your stars on the firmament? What were your main influences? I mean, you mentioned some, but still,
a lot of
do you also
a lot
go
of music.
To music?
A lot
do you
of
go
music,
visual
yeah.
arts
like,
or
like
architecture?
I was really excited by music that came out of punk rock music. Like when I was like 13, 14, 15, like it was the early 80s, and bands that came up there were like really important to me. That I think I like that there. This is what's great about punk rock isn't always the music so much, but the idea that anyone has access to get up on stage and say something. It doesn't matter if you can play or not. And I think that's really important to me. And I think that's probably why I'm casting people with no experience a lot of the time.
So kind of a democratization of the arts, that really everybody can be an actor or director if they choose and to practice. So would you see yourself almost like a punk band compared to a classical orchestra? So you are, that would be your tradition. But also, do you what colleagues on theater or performance world do you follow? Who do you?
Well, I mentioned the Worcester Group. I'm a fan. I still think they're the best. I love Liz and I love her work, and the company too. I mean, the actors, the designers. I'm fond of Romeo Castellucci's work, I like Sarah Benson, who's directing this play Samara at Soho Rep. I like Annie Baker. I like her work. I always feel like I draw a big blank because there's so many people that I admire. It's Forced Entertainment. I'm just thinking like globally now. But also like in dance, like Sarah Mitchelson has been a real influence for me, and really admire her work, and I've worked with her too. So it's like I feel like if I like somebody, I want to work with them. Like we've started producing playwrights and playwright directors now. So I'm thinking like Julia Jarko and Jackie Sibley's Drury, Tina Satter, Christina Masciotti. These are really important writers to me, and we want to, with this American Playwrights Division, we want to give them a platform.
I think all of them who have been also here at Prelude, speaking of Jackie Sibley's Drury, that Camera Obscura work you did, mm-hmm. Was that influenced by visual arts? I know that MoMA, where many, some of the exhibitions of contemporary artists who also use it. Are you in a dialogue with what you see in galleries, what you see in museums, or how did that collaboration happen, and how did you choose that Camera Obscura, that box people all went into a big...
It's a play. Jackie's play is really about photography, and the audience is invited to sit in a box, which turns out to be a camera, where you're inside a camera obscura, and one of the final images of the play is an actor standing outside the box and lit in such a way that their image is coming through a hole in the box and projected on, not projected, but appears on the wall upside down. It's like being inside an eyeball. You know, we were very lucky that it actually worked. Why are we talking about that? Oh, because of the art world and stuff.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't really know too much about that. I think I have an affinity for how artists think about composition and color and tone and atmosphere and time. But I didn't come up in that world, so I'm trying to bone up on that and learn more about it.
I think it could be a symbol for you. It's such a beautiful camera obscura, even so it doesn't completely stand on its head, but what you capture, the mood, the atmosphere of a reality which you create on stage is truly so very unique and so highly complicated to achieve. It's so easier, I guess, to put on a comedy, a well-written play, and everybody's entertained, but to achieve these kind of highly choreographed dance in the tradition of Japanese theater, in a way, Oisa Hirata, and his everyday theater movement of the people from Seoul or the Tokyo Notes or even Okada, where so few things happen on stage, but you say the mystery of life are in the everyday movements. They are taking the glass, and what you say is important, but also not important. It is truly unique. Before we open up to questions, what what really would you do, let's say, if you someone would give you resources, like we had Robert Lepage here and some Japanese donors said, here, I like your work, you have $50 million, and he got $50 million from the city of Quebec, and then the Canada gave him $20 million. He's creating now the Diamond, it's called an art center. But if you could create what you want for your own work, or what would you do? What is your vision? What is something you would couldn't do so far, but what you would dream about?
That's funny. I guess I have a kind of poverty mentality or something, because I think when I think about those numbers, I think, well, geez, I could I could put my kids through college with that. You know, it's like I haven't figured that one out. That's interesting too, because when I was doing these early plays, back in the day when I was first starting out, you know, it was really about like renting a rehearsal space for 3 hours. Actually, it hasn't really changed much, but it's like you rent a rehearsal space for 3 hours, and then people are working 3 and 4 jobs, whatever, and they come and they make time for this production, and everybody's busy, but you come together and you have this really small amount of time to put a story up. And I really believe that my approach or aesthetic, or however you want to say it, grew out of that economy of like, we don't have a lot of time, so I don't, if you could just stand still there and stay in that spot and not move around, then I can concentrate more on the writing and figure out if that's working. It's like, it's just kind of, I was a little taxed from a management point of view, and not able to really like dream up concepts in my off time, you know, a grand directing scheme where we can make a shape of an umbrella, you know, I don't know, I'm just thinking like, it didn't have time for that. It's like, I have to finish this play. And so, I'm sure it informed it. And I guess what I'm saying is I don't know. It's a lot of money. $15 million.
Just a million.
He got, Robert Lepage got $15
million.
$100,000. Well, that's like, yes. That's like normal. That's like, that's how much it costs to put on
But tell us,
a play these days, if you want to pay people.
You said earlier you're now looking ahead for 2 or 3 years of work. What is on your, what are the waves that are coming in? What are you doing? What are you planning?
Well, we talked about Samara, which I hope you can come see. It's at Soho Rep, and we start previews tomorrow. It's got music by Steve Earle, speaking of music and influences, one of my first, I count him among first heroes growing up. Great songwriter, singer-songwriter. He's in the play. He wrote the music, and he's in the play. So that's happening, and not at Soho Rep because they don't have their space. But it's on this. It's in Art New York Theater on 10th Avenue and 53rd, and you can go on the either New York City Players website, which is my company, or Soho Rep's website to get tickets for that. I don't know. It's kind of things are. I it's too early to talk about yet. I don't know. They're not having landed yet, so I'm just in limbo right now. But I'm thinking about a part two to The Evening, which is a show that I did at the Kitchen. So I think I'm going to start working on that this spring.
And you did a Shakespeare, Henry IV, which is BAM, you know, which was a legendary production or evening. When it also opened, but also the
legendary, O'Neill. Legendary for its success.
For
right.
Yes. There were two worlds colliding of a downtown world in, small spaces, as you said. All of a sudden, it was in a space where, which is huge, which is big, where people expect Peter Brooks or Peter Holbeck show, you know, out of that. But you did not compromise. I mean, you did what you always did, just in a different environment. But a lot of people walked out or were upset about it. And, of course, we saw that you were doing what you would always do, was just moved into a different space. Like sometimes theater happens in a theater, then in a gallery, and yours were then happening in that big space. Are you planning?
Except it was Shakespeare.
Mm-hmm.
That's a big.
Tell
a bit.
Yeah,
that's a big difference. Tell what?
the difference Shakespeare is?
Oh, I got hate mail from that show, and most of it was based in, like, you can do what you want with your work, but don't just, like, leave Shakespeare alone.
Even so, you reference Shakespeare in your theater for beginners, you know, take any random Shakespeare text, memorize, speak it in a neutral way, and you...
No, not in a neutral way. Speak it. Speak it out loud. So, I mean, say it out loud. Say it out loud. Say it so that you can hear it come back to you. Train your mouth to get around this language, you know, that we're not used to. I think that's great practice for an actor it's great practice if you want to be a person, you know, just like, and we haven't really talked about that, but I don't think, when I wrote this book, I was thinking about actors for sure and theater, but I like to think that it's open enough that you can appropriate it to whatever you want to do or whoever you are, and that's I'm heartened to hear from people that they're actually introducing it to visual art teachers are incorporating into their syllabus, and
it's a universal adaptation.
It's open that way. Shakespeare is really just try, like, pick up a Shakespeare play and just start saying it out loud. It's like, it's not easy. It is not easy to do that. We're not used to talking that way. We're not used to listening that way. So I encourage people, sure, to, and not just Shakespeare, but Ben Jonson or, Ibsen or Chekhov or, I guess it's probably better in English. Like, go to like an O'Neill play, you know, and like, like something. Yeah,
O'Neill. You did The Long Journey, but how does that experience for you to do a classical text or work with it?
With O'Neill? Well, I like O'Neill because he's American. That's important to me. He's like the birth of American theater in terms of, like, it was like a lot of imports up till then. We were relying on melodrama and stuff that his dad was doing, right? And he's also cool because he was in New York. He was experimental. He was trying to find different forms and look at what theater can yield. I like how he goes to the Greeks, and really pulls on the myth element and finds that in an American milieu.
Wasn't his company also called for a while New York City Players, or wasn't his company of what he worked?
New York City Players, no.
Something like it.
No, I would be shocked.
Yeah. So you're not planning other adaptations, or you will be writing your own your work for the next foreseeable future and keep on doing that. Last thing you said, you know, you hope that becoming a better actor also makes you a better person.
Well, like, listening, you say, right? Listening. Yep. That's something that we should all do. We can all be better at. I think that's the most important thing as an actor, is listening. And it so happens that it's handy if you're a person, you know. I think it's important.
Good. So I think so. Thank you so much. And let's put some lights up for the audience. And let's take some questions again. We are recording the evening, so we will bring you a mic. So maybe say who you are and make a comment. And any session, Peter.
Thanks, Richard. My name's Peter Eckersall. There's a book written about you by Sarah Gorman, I believe, which is a very lengthy introduction to your work, where she introduces us to some kind of key thematic ideas like amateurism, and she also puts your work in a context of American frontier kind of context. And I just wonder if you... It's a kind of dangerous question for an academic to ask an artist, whether you engage with that kind of dialogue with her to write that book, or did you respond to that? Do you relate to the kind of readings in that book? Do they make sense to you of an observation of your work? Could you talk a little bit about that?
I'm happy that the book exists, and I spoke with Sarah quite a bit. We met periodically as she was writing it. I like Sarah Gorman. I have to admit that I can't. It's an uncomfortable situation to read what things. I don't know. It's not the most. It's not something that I seek. I don't seek out what the work means. You know. I don't. I guess, in most critical writing about my work, I kind of feel like that's, you know, you work your side of the street, I'll work mine. That's my approach. And it seems like a helpful thing to have out there. I have read it, but it was as I was thinking about this book, and so I think I was trying to carve out these distinctions for myself as Sarah was working on that.
Other comments or?
Go ahead. Oh, you need a mic.
Sorry.
Can you just tell me how you came to work with Steve Earle and just talk a little bit about the mechanics of the collaboration?
Yeah. Sarah said she wanted to do, so this play that I wrote knowing that I wouldn't direct it, and Sarah had the idea to put music in it. And I thought, well, who I would like to propose music, you know, especially if I'm not writing it, because, you know, my shows, I normally write the music for it. And I saw that he played a benefit for Soho Rep, so I knew there was a connection, and I asked Sarah about it, and she's like, yeah, you know somebody on our board, this and that. And so I wrote a letter, a very fawning letter, telling him how much I admire his work and this and that, and then got him the play and the letter somehow. He read the play. He, to my surprise, he liked the play, and it turns out he's a big theater buff. And I remember he told Sarah and I at an early meeting, like he moved to New York to breathe the same air as Tony Kushner. Like we weren't expecting that, you know. And if you know Steve's work, you never would really know that. But he was like, he's kind of a theater nerd in high school in Tennessee. He goes to theater a lot. He likes Mark Rylance and he's really out there. He was doing the music, and then slowly he got roped into being in the show. So he's actually performing in the play as well now.
So he basically went off with your play and then at some point came back with a bunch of songs.
Well, yeah. To answer the second part of your question, was like work. We had workshops, and some of them were with the whole company. One was just with Steve and the music. So he was around. I was impressed with how he didn't really come to the early rehearsals with any music, but he would hang out and he would be there, and he'd be interested in watching and didn't feel like he had to. I don't know. I was just surprised at how. And then so he started reading the stage directions, and in this play, one of the conceits is that the stage directions take over. So these like little descriptive headers at the top of each scene become longer and longer until it's like that's all it is. It turns into prose basically, and so he's that's his function in this play, and that grew through these, just evolved gradually through these workshops. And then he was also, of course, writing music, and I think it's really I'm impressed with what he's what's happening musically in the play.
Hi, I want to ask you about your participation in the Whitney Biennial in 2012, because there's increasing amounts of the performing arts being migrated into gallery spaces. But what you did with that opportunity was quite distinct in terms of having continuous rehearsals in the space rather than using it as a place to perform at a set time in a, you know, a ticketed event like Sarah Michelson did at during that period. So how did you arrive at that format, and how did it go for you? Is that something you would ever do again?
Oh, I would do it again. Yeah, I like getting out of the framework of a theater. And the way that came about was meeting with Jay Sanders and Elizabeth Sussman, and we had meetings about what it could be, and we knew that we'd have this option of doing plays, but somehow having an assigned time didn't satisfy me. So we were thinking about like what's a temporal equivalent in terms of like you look at museum hours and you look at what happens in rehearsal, and they match up pretty much. You know, you have a rehearsal day, if you're lucky, you know, you can work all day. So it came out of trying to identify like what is this, what's the scene, what's the Whitney scene like, what are the mechanics of the day, and trying to match up something in theater with that. And that's how we came upon the rehearsal idea. I wrote a play that was special for that, for the biennial, and it was open to the public. People came in, they trafficked through. Sometimes there was no one there, sometimes it was very crowded, but meanwhile we're rehearsing. And I learned a lot.
Was the play different to, you said you wrote a play specially for it. Is that because an existing play wouldn't have worked in that context? You needed to write something that
could
sustain the noise and the contingency of the traffic?
Yeah. Somehow to do a play that exists felt kind of contrived to me, to bring that in. Like, here's a play that I already directed, and I'm doing you the favor of directing it again to show you what it's like. We were actually putting together a play, and I felt that was important.
Hi. You answered the questions about collaborating with the directors or the playwright and the actors and the musicians, but I wondered if you had a methodology of working with designers and what that would be.
Well, that's a great question. In the book, I added a chapter. It's like the chapters are learn your lines, learn your blocking, warm up, things that are really pragmatic for the actor.
Build a set.
But then I put in build a set, which sounds like a red herring, but it's I enjoy thinking about the correlatives between set building and acting. And I think if an actor, I've never done this before, so I'm going out on a limb in this book here, because I don't do this as a practice, but I think it would be really helpful for the actor to build a set. Because, you know, you're talking about like what, you're talking about building fiction, really. I'm talking about building fiction. And if an actor can build a set, and decide, for example, well, here's where the line ends. It's like this right here on this M. We're going to end the fiction here. This is where our set starts, and here's where the rest of the theater is. Like that's an important thing to establish, and think about. Like it's not here. It's here. Well, why? What's the difference? Why can't it be here? You know, this seems like a fine. Well, maybe it can, but. But usually it's like, well, no, this is better because of certain sight lines, or this is better because of the visual composition, or what's revealed later, or whatever. You know, it's like these, and most of the time the actor spends their time thinking about this in a very abstract place in their head. Like, what's fictional about what I'm doing? What's real about what I'm doing? And I think if you can have an experience where you can answer those questions, not just in a scenic way, but also in a practical way. Like I believe that if an actor knows where they are and how this building came to be, that it has that has an impact on how they perform. That will influence how they perform, because what you're really talking about is awareness and grounding and knowing the one of the first things we do if we're like touring to a theater is like let's tour the whole place, let's know like how because that's a very practical thing, like how how loudly should I shall I speak so that everyone can hear me? Doesn't that sound fake? You know, that comes up too. Does it sound like I'm shouting? Like, you know, and usually the answer is no. It sounds like I hear you, so I'm listening to what you're saying. And, you know, so you can't escape that especially in these places where you're talking to 300 or 400 people, whatever. Oh, but in terms of talking to designers, sorry, that was a tangent. In terms of talking with designers, that it goes the other way too. Like, you know, we talk to actors about why they're here or what's important, what do we need, what's necessary. That's that's a theme that runs through rehearsal, and it's also something that carries over for the designers as well. Like I work with Sasha Van Riel quite a bit. She's been my designer on a number of shows, and it's helpful. It's something that I learned from her when she's like, because she's like, well, what does this mean when you wrote this thing? And it's like, I don't want to say what it means. I want it to, yeah, but we still have to make a decision. So it's like, what's the decision going to be? Like, what is this trying to say? These are good questions, and it's a good conversation, I think.
Hi. My name is Kathy, and just now you mentioned the list of companies or writers such as Wooster Group or Annie Baker you admire or under influence. May I add Samuel Beckett into the list? And if it
all right.
If it is, to what extent or at what point you admire him or influenced by him? If not, then what do you think of him and his plays? Thank you.
I think he had a great haircut. And I'm certainly not an expert on Beckett, and I'm not really drawn to it. I'm not gonna lie. I admire the work. I respect the intellect that made the work, but I feel like if I had to direct a Beckett play, it would be very funny. I would try to find the humor, and I think that that's not something that really gets brought out in a lot of. You know, did you ever see this? If you like Beckett, you should check this out. He did this thing called Film, where he worked with Buster Keaton, and I feel like that says a lot about what he was looking for in his. In his work, and I know he admired clowning, and I think it takes a special sensibility to bring that out, and I don't really see that much with Beckett, but I found the writing hard for me to get into, unlike O'Neill, where I feel like, oh yeah, I'm in there, you know, or even like Sam Shepard, where I'm just like, yeah, yeah, you know, or Irene Fornes, like, yeah, I can go, you know, that stuff feels like right there for me. Brian Friel, you know, Carol Churchill, like these are people that I feel like I can access more.
Maybe a question about songs in your like Brecht, you put it sometimes songs in The House, which we screened in the afternoon, but also in The Good Samaritans. I know you're a musician. You once came here with the Taylor guitar. But what role do you see for songs? Why do you put in songs? Why do they burst into singing like in the Abrams Art Center? Is that something you want to explore on and off? Or are you going to write a musical? Since you started with Oklahoma, what is your relation to
it? Well, you could make an argument that I'm making musicals with these songs.
Yes,
right?
Could, yeah.
And yeah, I think that's where it comes from. It comes from those very early, those years where I was watching my sister, and also performing in them in high school. These classic American, it's an American genre, you know. It's really, I think that's great. And I'm also, you know, again, the band thing was coming in. I was trying to find a way to incorporate that when I was writing. And yeah, it's like, I think what why Oklahoma was innovative and important was that it was the first example of a musical that was forwarding the story through the songs. And I think that's what these songs do in the plays, is that if they're not pushing the action forward, then they're certainly telling you more about the character that the text isn't. And I enjoy that. It's also like it's like one of the building blocks of theater. You have bodies, you have story, and music. I feel like it's very essential to me.
Thank you. So I think if I were to be blindfolded and driven to a theater and there was no billboards and no programs and I was sat down and the blindfold was taken off and the show starts, if it was one of your plays, I think I would like to say it would take me about 15 seconds to identify that it was one of your plays, but I know that it would be like a couple minutes at most. Your style, your work is unmistakably your work. You have a remarkable signature to your aesthetic, and yet, this is my experience, your work has never calcified into mannerism. Your style is so yours, but it's always fresh at the same time. I wonder, is this something that you're conscious of? Do you consciously have to be in relation with the specter of mannerism when you're making work and when you've been making work for so long? If you have been conscious of this, like, how have you, it's kind of remarkable to me, even, you know, some of my heroes, their later work, their middle to late work, you see Cassavetes, I'm thinking of Cassavetes, you see a little bit of mannerism in late Cassavetes. How have you related to that specter with making so much work that is so yours?
Well, a lot of people would disagree with you, I think, on that. But I thank you for that. That's very nice to hear. This is not a friend of mine. I said early on that when I was trained as an actor, that emotional memory had its place. You know, this kind of traditional Stanislavskian-based training for the actor has its place. And I don't want people to behave like robots. That's not interesting to me. Or behave like, to be deadpan. I'm thinking of the adjectives that people use in writing about my work. Like, that's not, if I was going for that, then the calcification would happen. And so I keep that idea of what is available to the actor in terms of not just emotional memory, but logic, consequence. That's got to be always at the disposal of the people making the thing. And not that it gets used, but it's there. You know, it's a very broad thing to say emotional memory. I don't know if everybody knows what that means, but what you're really saying is that you're using parts of your life as an actor to justify situations that you find in the script. So you remember how you felt and you apply that. I don't even know if people do that anymore, if actors do that, if they actually take the time to do that. But I think it could include being open to the logic or consequence of a situation where you tell me that my mother has passed away or that she's died suddenly or whatever. I don't want to be like, I don't want to appear like anything. I don't want it to be, I was going to say robotic, but I really don't want it to be anything. I don't want it to be anything. And that's what's really cool about the neutrality exercises from Jacques Lecoq, because what he was really trying to get was the actor to communicate something, like just throw a piece of paper or whatever, walk through the room or drink some water without any adjectives at all. And I don't want to accept that that is futile. And so it's, I won't accept it. I don't accept it that that's a futile thing. And I keep getting met with the failure of that. The failure of that is something that I keep encountering.
You actually mentioned that as an exercise. He did work with masks, neutral masks, and you say, I'm actually doing the same just without the mask, right, for your actors.
Well, I wanted to appropriate it in that way, because if you think it's hard to move without communicating adjectives, try speaking text without communicating any adjectives. And yet you can, in terms of appropriating, why not? But I've moved away from that. I don't think that that's something that I'm more one, like I was talking about one-to-one. I'm more one-to-one. I'm more like, let's solve this together. And it's more of a dialogue based on the person rather than trying to find some kind of notion, some standard of neutrality.
So I really appreciate the thoughtfulness and the time you're just working these answers out with us, because it's a fascinating conversation. When you're talking about the one-to-one and how this seems like that's a kind of a dominant thing you're doing right now, are you still looking for something that's going to unify it as a whole with all these different, or is that something that's sort of left to a Cagean chance?
Well, the story is what, and that's a great question, you know, the story is what connects. For me, in my work, I'm story based. Like these plays are stories that I made up, mostly. One of them's based on a court deposition that actually happened. But anyway, that's what connects the one to ones for me. And I get excited in rehearsal when the story becomes a thing that everybody follows. It's a relief. I wrote the play, and I'm glad it's not about me. You know, I'm now, because it's a relief that it's this thing that is now has its own rules that everybody follows. Everyone is in service of this, the writer, the director, the actors, the designers. We now have this, like, it has a set of rules, and that's super exciting to liberate something like that. And that is probably why I come back each time. Like, I don't know, stop.
One of the things I really admire about your work and am picking up from a lot of the things you're saying today is the idea of presence, in your presence with the actors in that one-to-one relationship, but also the actor's presence with the audience, the actor's presence with each other, the audience's presence with the actors, the way that that kind of neutrality you're talking about by not interpreting the experience already leaves everybody open to experience it in the present. And so I'm interested in hearing about your work on film, having watched some of the films earlier today, how you feel, what it is for you both making those films and also what it's like for you to see them and to see your work in a way that is actually perfectly repeatable.
The thing about film, it's like, it's a frame, right? And you, unlike theater, you can't see what's outside of it. So you're really, as a viewer, you're really dealing with what's inside the frame. And it's a contrivance that way. And so it has its own rules. And I don't think that you can say that I'm an actor and I can. This is going to sound obvious, I guess, but I don't. If you're a theater actor, you can't just go into a film and say I'm going to behave like I do when I'm on stage. But what that means is that there is a different set of, I don't want to say rules, but there's different parameters for behavior, because you're really like talking about behavior. How do you behave when the camera's like when you have to say these lines that you didn't that you've memorized that are not, you know, or even if you're not, it's like you say these lines and there's a camera pointed at you, and it's just a different set of responsibilities. It's a different approach, and you know, I could have called this Acting for Beginners, this book. It's Theater for Beginners, because I really am interested in theater, and I'm interested in what it yields. I'm not a filmmaker, but I am like a lazy film buff. You know, I like I can't remember the names of any directors or movies, but I do like to watch movies, and I am interested in that. But in terms of acting, I think it's just it's apples and oranges. It's almost like doctors and lawyers. It's like I think it's like a very different pursuit. Oh, but I want to say one thing about that. One thing we did do with the darkness, you're talking about the darkness of this Reading. One thing that I wanted to do, kind of like the Whitney thing, where it's like what can we bring from theater into this medium? It's a one-take movie. It's a one-take video, so it's like everything. We had like about several, like five, six locations that the main character walked to, but the camera never stopped rolling, and I wanted to keep it as live as possible.
So Farah Sheroz's book, Theater for Beginners. Let me ask you a question as a beginner. I cannot understand, I cannot comprehend popularity of Chekhov in America. Americans are doers. In many ways, from outside, they look like very effective, productive robots. What they can find in Chekhov's reflection, in his character, who doing nothing, only talking, only reflection, empty talk, empty life. What they see in Chekhov?
What is in Chekhov?
Yes, what they see in Chekhov.
Place. What do I see in Chekhov?
No, in general. You wrote a book. Not your personal opinion. In general, how society, American society, react to Chekhov? Where is roots of his popularity?
Can Frank answer that question?
I think also it's a good question. We can leave in the room, you know, but you know, it's a big question and to reflect about. It's not the theme of our evening tonight, but I think it is a good one and somehow related to it, because one could look at your plays as a Chekhovian version of an American realness, but you try to find out that the stillness, the openness, the interpretation, how you look at that scene, that character, what it produces, your own memory, because you do not interpret it, you don't do preach to it for the audience. There's a lot of open and space, and that is why it's so fascinating and so complicated to do. As also Tadashi Suzuki said, you know, no three sisters go in their backyards and burst into a song. It looks like all real, but of course they don't do that. As they don't do in a soup kitchen and go on the table and sing a song. So I think there are some connections and to be found out, and in a way an updated a model that tries to explain the world and give the meaning. And as you wrote in the book, and maybe we can also end on this, that you said is something matters. You know, you want to lift something up, and something does matter. And it is not important how it looks or what they say, but why. That's what is important. And I think we got a little insight tonight in why you do this, why you create the work, and what that big question is, why, and where theater might be able to help us to connect, you know, and to this world. So I would like to thank you all very much for coming and for listening. And we're going to have a little reception here if you have a little bit of time, if there are additional things people would like to ask. So thank you very much, and I hope I read a little bit to your liking.
I'm putting you on the list, Frank.
Yes. I am there. So thank you very much, and again, really thank you for taking the time and for answering these questions and
thank you
for being here. Thank you all.